Hi, and welcome to Somerville Media Center Live. I'm Joe Lynch. Today is Friday, March 27th, 2020. I am so pleased to be joined today by City Council President Matt McLaughlin. Matt, how you doing?
I'm doing all right, all things considered. Joe, how are you doing?
I'm doing very well, thank you. How has life been in the past 3 weeks at the City Council, City of Somerville?
Well, it's definitely been an interesting time and unprecedented time so far as we know. We held a full city council meeting a couple weeks ago in person, and that was the last time I saw my colleagues in a professional setting. Basically, we had that meeting, and at the time we were told we couldn't have remote meetings because of open meeting law in the state, and the very next day, Governor Baker eased up open meeting law to allow remote meetings. So we had our first remote meetings this week. On Tuesday, we had a public health meeting where we dealt exclusively with coronavirus, COVID-19. And then Wednesday, we had a finance meeting because that's one of the very important committees that we have to keep going in order to keep the city functional. And then last night, we had our full city council meeting, which was the first ever, so far as we know, remote meeting of the city council. That went fairly smoothly, considering this is all new to us. So, you know, we're focusing very heavily on the current crisis before us and just trying to make sure the government stays functional so that people get the resources they need.
Great. So, Matt, I want to just take a second to give some stats because we're going to try to stay very, very Somerville centric on this thing. I looked up the stats this morning. In Massachusetts, there are now 2,500 confirmed cases of COVID-19 with 25 dead. In Somerville, we have 26 confirmed cases as of Friday morning, and there are no morbidity rates to that. So, you know, what we're going to try to do with these live broadcasts is to keep people up to date. The mayor, as the executive office in this city, has the tools of the communication department at his disposal. We thought it would be a good idea to have the city council president speaking directly to the city of Somerville residents and businesses about what your role is going forward, your role as the Somerville City Council. So you made reference to the fact that you met last night in a virtual city council meeting and that it went fairly well. My question to you is, where can people find those future for the foreseeable future? Where can they find those to view those?
So all of our city meetings, just like before this happened, can be found on the City of Somerville's website, somervillema.gov, under the City Council section. So that hasn't changed. What has changed is the fact that, you know, people just can't be present for the meetings. So okay. This makes things complicated in terms of public hearings and getting testimony from people. So we're working on that as well. But you can find all of these videos on the City of Somerville website.
And these are on a day delay basis, I take it, because you're taping.
I think that they should have. Yeah, they're probably still on a day delay. Usually during a full video city council meeting, it's live. And you can still go on it's called GoTo Media. It's a website that you can log into. Okay. Somerville Journal had an article about this where you can just log in directly to the meeting and you can participate in the meeting as well. GoToMeeting.com.
Right. So what I'm trying to do, Matt, is for the Somerville public who are used to watching your council meetings live on Channel 22, but that is no longer available. Is that correct?
Yeah, it's not available on the channels, but you can pick it up on the website, GoToMedia.com. And you can also look at it after the fact during this on the City of Somerville's website.
Okay. And then I know there's a lot of things that are coming down the pike in terms of how the city is going to conduct virtual public hearings. So I know you, as president of the council, you have sole discretion on whether or not you're going to let anybody speak at your council meetings. If they are open to the public as public hearings, you know, let me give, for instance, an Eversource public hearing. You have to be able to broadcast that and get input from the public. But other than that, there are other commissions, other boards, other things such as the Zoning Board of Appeals, the planning board, all of that will come out of the mayor's office as to how they're going to proceed doing those. Is that a correct statement?
Yeah, I would say it's correct. And what we're doing now is definitely trying as hard as possible to not have to do the public hearings, only in case of certain emergencies. And as of today, there's been a halt on construction. So the only permits will be given for emergency situations. And public utilities can sometimes be one of those. So usually we have a public hearing before every meeting regarding something like, you know, you want to lay wires or gas pipes and things like that. So that will still go on as a needs-based situation. And we'll still have the same process where people are notified by mail or by letter, telling them about a project in their neighborhood, and they'll have access through the public here, through the GoTo website to participate.
So I'm sensing that the city is slowly but surely trying to prioritize those things that are in the interest of public health and public safety.
Yeah, for me especially, I think it's really important for us to hunker down and focus on this crisis before us. So I've laid guidelines to the council saying that we should really be focusing on what's before us, which means we're having a weekly public health and safety meeting. We usually meet once a month, and now we're going to meet weekly with a committee of the whole, which means that all councilors will be involved in that meeting. That'll be every Monday at 6 o'clock or 6:30, so people can tune in and watch that. And then we also have oversight over the budget and financial matters, and that just can't stop with the crisis before us. So we had a finance committee meeting on Wednesday where we approved funding grants with no match required to address coronavirus in the city. And then Thursday we had a full meeting. So, and then we also preparing possible emergency legislation as needed from the Legislative Matters Committee. So those three committees, finance, legislative matters, public health, to me are the most important right now. And as we continue, and if we find that we're capable of taking on more than that, we will do that. But I'm instructed everybody that this is the matter before us right now, and it definitely takes precedence over a lot of important things.
Yeah, great. So, Matt, you know, for the public that's out there, I think, you know, the on the ground person, the person that's closest to them in terms of an elected official, usually is their city councilor. So you, in the case, you have Ward 1, you know, Mary Jo Rossetti, Ward 7. Those are the folks, those are the first line.
Katiana, Ward 7, Mary Jo's at large.
My apologies to Katiana Ballantyne. So what we've got is you're hearing directly from the constituents who are being most affected by this. And you have to kind of balance, we understand the angst that's out there, but you also have a city government to assist in running. So the mayor is the executive, you guys are the legislative body, and you've got to prioritize things the way that you see fit as president.
Yeah, that's correct. And right now, what's before us is what's most important. And there are a number of things that I really care about that have been put on hold. During my inaugural speech, I talked about the people's budget, where we really want to solicit information from the public and ask them what's important in the annual budget. And that's really just completely on hold now because we can't have public meetings. And the whole point of that was to solicit information from people you usually don't hear from. And they're even harder now than ever to get a hold of. So although I care very much about that, getting through this is the most important thing right now. We've talked about charter reform. That obviously has to wait. And fortunately, you know, we're moving forward on some affordable housing issues because people in the planning department have more time than some other departments. But I really think it's important not only for us and for the residents that we focus on this crisis, but also for the city staff who are being reallocated. Maybe they're doing jobs that aren't in their job description because they're addressing the problem before us. We want to make sure that they have the time to address that. And sometimes, you know, some constituent issues and some city council issues are going to have to wait a little bit while we get through this.
And my apologies to the rest of the council. You know, I asked you how you were doing, how they were feeling. All of your 10 colleagues are fine.
Yeah, they're all doing well. And I made sure I call them regularly. I spent a day calling all the city councilors and the chair of the school committee just to ask them how they're doing. with no real agenda set up, just to check in, make sure they're healthy and their families are being taken care of. They're all doing well. And that's also something in a column I wrote recently, I highly recommend other people do, is to pick up the phone and call somebody you care about and make sure they're okay. Make sure that they have the supplies necessary that they need. And just make sure they're not lonely, because while we're sheltering in place or keeping our social distance, there's some people who may not get to see another human being for a while. So it'd be very good to for everybody just look out for each other.
Great advice, Matt. Thanks. I mean, my own personal experience is I'm blown away by the kindness that's being shown in my own little neighborhood here. But let's go back to how things are operating. For a general sense, I think most people have gotten into the rhythm now, is that the federal government is making announcements pretty much in the late morning. And then it's very quickly followed by the governor of Massachusetts figuring out those directives and trying to announce timely and accurate information to the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. Those are then followed by announcements that are coming out of the city of Somerville, whether they are directly by the mayor or they're done by other means, email, Facebook, all kinds of social media platforms. So I guess when I look at this, you know, there's a structure in place that there are certain things the state can do outside of the purview of the federal government. There are certain things the city can do outside of the purview of the state government. But when it comes to the laws, you know, people have been asking me, Matt, over the last couple of weeks, why does it take so long to enact something? Do you want to try to walk people through that? Maybe not from the federal standpoint, but from the state standpoint.
I mean, unfortunately, democracy can be slow sometimes. And what we're seeing now is some governors and some mayors using executive authority and using emergency powers to expedite the process. And that's something that on a regular day, I would have an issue with. But now that we're in a crisis and we're trying to help people as quickly as possible, I think our mayor, Curtatone, has done a great job using his executive authority responsibly and making sure that people's needs are being addressed, because that's the most important thing right now. Sometimes process has to wait in order, or process has to be put aside in order to get people the resources they need. So I think your question is, why do things move so slow? Is because our government was made to move slow so that people don't make decisions that we'd later regret. And you look at the setup of our state constitution, you look up the setup of our national constitution, it's really set up to kind of thoughtfully think everything through and not make any decisions unless there's a real consensus or at least a plurality of votes. So that the reason why it's moving slow is because government always moves slow. But, you know, our mayor is using his executive authority to do what needs to be done. Our governor is using that to an extent. And, you know, the federal government finally, I just saw today the House passed that stimulus package that the Senate passed. So they're assuming the president will sign it. That's some pretty fast moving considering, you know, how difficult it's been to get any legislation passed on the federal level. So I do think that, you know, people are trying, they're taking this seriously, and we're trying to move forward and take care as many people as possible.
Well, I agree with you that sometimes a government, being the machine that it is, can't turn on a dime. It has to have that process that it goes through. But I agree with you, you know, in terms of the local and the state level, in how we're seeing it, how we are seeing it handled by the mayor, the city council, the governor. We just kind of wish that the federal government could act as fast as they, as locally and in the Commonwealth that we are. So the question that I have for you is it the sense from the Somerville City Council that we are doing everything that we need to do within the confines of the Commonwealth's laws, or are there some other things that we can do locally? You wanted to talk about some of the initiatives that we have locally that are trying to help people, not next week, not next month, but today. Do you want to address some of those things?
Sure. Well, I first say, you know, you asked me to keep it local, so I'll try to not give my thoughts on what's happening on the federal level, but you can imagine how I feel about that. And I do believe the governor has reacted in ways that is in some ways that I definitely support. He came forward and advised everybody to stay at home and is taking precautions now. Sometimes it's a very tough decision to make. I have to give the executives across this country a lot of credit for having to deal with this, because you know, every decision you make has consequences, and people aren't going to be happy with some of the decisions made.
Matt, excuse me. It bears worth noting once again that when the governor suggests or orders, that goes for us too.
Yeah. Well, one of the big things we had, you know, the city of Somerville started earlier than a lot of places across the state in closing bars and restaurants and public utilities, some things that we shut down faster than the governor's office did. And then the governor came forward and had very similar policies than what we had. And that's really important, because if Somerville's the only city doing this, if we issued a shelter in place order and no other city in the state is doing it, it's really not going to have the effect that's necessary.
Right. Because people are still on the move. We don't have borders.
I mean, yeah, exactly. I know. I mean, it's a pandemic, so it's international. So we really need a very top-down response to all of this.
So if you, as city council president, had any other conversations, say, with, I know you work over in Cambridge, but are you in touch with the city council over in Cambridge, the Medford folks?
Yeah, well, I work with, Mayor Curtatone has invited me to teleconference meetings with mayors throughout the Commonwealth, and that's one of the great things that he's done, is like he took the initiative on this. He's not in charge of it. But he made himself the point person for mayors across Massachusetts to address this problem. So when issues weren't being addressed on the state and federal level, we started communicating with other cities to make sure that we're all on the same page. And I definitely think that has led to a lot of the changes that were necessary.
So it was putting pressure from the local level, trying to push that up through the states and into the federal government.
Yeah, I would say it's polite pressure, because it's saying we're going to do this and we hope you do the same. And I definitely think I'll tell you, in one of the conferences I was at with the mayor and with mayors from across the state, we were talking about a number of precautions to take. And then while we were at that meeting, the governor held a press conference and announced almost identical processes. So it's very important that this happens again, because if Somerville does one thing and Cambridge does another and Boston does another, Swampscott does something different, it's not going to have the impact needed. And this is really a collective, it's a human issue right now. Human beings across the planet should be working together to address this crisis.
Yeah, I've been noticing how certain changes are getting done at the federal level too, you know, that the pressure from the governors is what's kind of, not forcing, but it's getting the federal government to rethink some of the things they think they're going to do. You know, when it comes down to all of this, Matt, no offense whatsoever, but when it comes down to something that is going to affect my health, I usually listen to people in medicine first. And Dr. Fauci,
I do as well. So
yeah,
every guidance I'm taking is from professionals. I'm not making ideas up on my own.
Dr. Fauci is the one that I'm paying attention to every day they come on television. Let's bring it back locally again. You did mention that you wanted to talk about some initiatives that you wanted to give a special shout out to.
Yeah, so there's a number of actions going on. And I wrote a column that you can read in the Somerville newspapers, just talking about trying to find purpose during difficult times. And that's something I always try to do. I was in the military and I've dealt with several crisis issues locally. And the way I've gotten myself through those crises is by focusing on what I can do, and even the small things, because like big and small, if everybody took a little action to take care of each other, it would go a long way. So I would say, you know, obviously the first thing that everyone should have heard already is you should wash your hands regularly, keep a social distance from people, don't go to crowded events. Don't go places where you're less than six feet close to somebody. Wash your hands, don't touch your face, and keep social distance. Those are the messages everyone should have heard already, and they should really be taking that seriously. And I really think if people were to shelter in place, go out limited, maybe go out for a walk or a bike ride once a day, just to get some air and keep distance from people. If people took care of themselves that way, then it will help other people. So people can find purpose just by taking care of themselves in that matter. But if people wanted to do more, there are a number of needs that people really have. And the most pressing one to me is the Cambridge Health Alliance that runs Somerville Hospital. They're looking at a potential lack of supplies for basic needs like gloves, goggles, masks, things that are going to affect their staff, which in turn is going to affect their ability to take care of our residents. And I just saw today, Boston Mass General Hospital, their staff are coming down with coronavirus.
Matt, can we take it back to the local level for one minute?
Yeah.
My understanding is that the Cambridge Health Alliance facility on Highland Ave is no longer a fully functional hospital. Is that a true statement?
No, there was plans to get rid of the emergency room, but those plans have been put on hold.
How about hospital beds?
They have limited hospital beds, but they still have an emergency room. They got rid of things like drug rehab a few years ago. So, I mean, they're already limited in their capacity, but they do have an emergency room that people can go to.
What is the facility doing with the former hospital rooms up there? Are they making preparation that if they need to, that the former Somerville Hospital be converted back into some type of a triage center?
So the Somerville Hospital, the most important thing for the Somerville Hospital right now is the emergency room is intact. I don't know what they're doing about beds themselves, but Tufts University has announced that they will allow us to use their rooms for people in quarantine. And then we also have help from the Holiday Inn in Somerville. So triage is being set up. I'm not sure what Somerville Hospital specifically is doing in terms of beds. But okay. It is a place that people can get tested if they're Cambridge Health Alliance members. And so they have the COVID-19 tests, and it is a place, it's a resource for people.
So the reason I asked the question, Matt, as the Somerville public becomes more heightened, they're looking at, okay, if I get sick and I have to be hospitalized, can I be hospitalized in Somerville? And quite frankly, I don't think we have that at Somerville Hospital yet.
That's possible, but I would say, this is going to be a serious issue as the weeks go on, too. So I don't want to downplay it, but we do have other resources available to us, such as Tufts University, Holiday Inn.
And the Boston hospitals.
Yeah, in the Boston hospitals. We're very lucky to be in the part of the world we're in terms of medical care. But this is going to be a significant burden put on people, and I'm really concerned that our hospitals don't have the basic supplies necessary. And the fact that they're asking people for donations is very alarming, and people should do whatever they can to help these people. So the Somerville Hospital is looking for masks, surgical masks. They're looking for goggles. They're looking for aprons, anything that people can offer as donations. And Renee Scott, one of our great Somerville volunteer residents in the community, she's actually helping to make the surgical masks necessary that are in severe shortage. And if people are really interested in helping her make those masks, they can email her at phmaskmaker@gmail.com.
Great.
So it's phmaskmaker@gmail.com. And that's definitely something I think we should definitely try to help as much as possible. And if people happen to have these supplies, you can go to the Cambridge Health Alliance website and learn how to make donations to them.
Who else do you want to give a shout out to, Matt?
So I had a great time yesterday. Me and several other counselors helped the Council on Aging distribute aid packages to seniors so that they don't have to go outside and go shopping. And Cindy Hickey from the Council on Aging has been organizing this, and they're doing a great job. They're doing weekly supply drops that I hope to participate in. And if people want to participate in that, they can call the Council on Aging at 617-625-6600, extension 2317, and offer to volunteer.
People are also asking me directly, Matt, when do they think Somerville City Hall will reopen to the public? I have no answer because I don't know. Any sense?
I would say they just announced that the city buildings are going to be closed till May now.
May 4th.
I would tell people expect them to be closed indefinitely. until this crisis is dealt with, city buildings will not be open to the public. So as of right now, it was May, it was April before. So people should just expect it to be closed until otherwise notified.
But the council will continue on its business twice a month in the regularly scheduled city council meetings.
We will still have our twice a month council meetings as well as all the committee meetings that are necessary to address the issue at hand.
It's time to start reining them in, Matt. They have to be clear, concise, and accurate when they get a hold of the microphone and the camera lens these days, huh?
Well, you know, that was my goal before all of this, was to focus our efforts on important matters. And we did a really good job. I mean, I became council president in January, and it's March now, so it's been less than 3 months. And before this crisis happened, we were moving pretty smoothly. And unfortunately now some important matters are going to have to be put aside, but that's for the sake of everybody, because we have to survive this before we really think about other important issues. I've been trying to rein people in and focus our efforts.
Here's a recommendation for you, Matt. I've been on both sides of the gavel. I control the mic, and sometimes I have to be a public participant. Why don't you give your colleagues on the council the buzzer? So when the red light goes off, their time to speak is up.
Yeah, I ran that by before, actually, and there didn't seem to be a consensus. I rely on their votes to be council president, so I'm not sure I can do that. But people, I would tell you, we had a meeting the other day. It was remotely held. It was under 2 hours, and we got a lot of important things done.
Let's try to get them under an hour, Matt.
Oh, come on. I'm lucky that it's under 3 hours. So,
City Council President Matt McLaughlin from the City of Somerville, I want to thank you for joining us on this live broadcast from the Somerville Media Center Live. Matt, please stay safe, stay informed, and you're welcome back anytime.
All right. Thanks a lot, Joe. Take care of everybody.
Thank you, Matt.